Hello, wonderful people. Thank you for joining. Let's folks triple in. Hello, hello. You are in the right place if you're looking for a webinar on unlocking potential, a guide to influencing teams, and enhancing performance. Feel free to head on over to chat and let me know where you're dialing in from. My name is Teila, and I'm on the ThinkHuman team, and I'm dialing in from Atlanta, Georgia. All right, Huntsville, Alabama, not too far, Heather. Hey, Victoria, good to see you here in the South. I hope you are prepared for the tropical storm this week. I love it. Hey, Oakland, great to see you all in the house. All right, if you're just joining, feel free to head over to chat. Let us know where you're dialing in from. Welcome, welcome. I love this. We have folks from coast to coast. It's the same with our panelists, too, so this is great. We got one in every time zone. Love it. And Canada, welcome, welcome. All right, we're going to get started here shortly. If you're just joining, let us know where you are dialing in from. Bay Area. Welcome, welcome, folks. Thanks for joining. I love that. All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. Hello, wonderful people. My name is Teila. I'm on the ThinkHuman team here. If you've been to our events before, chances are you've probably seen me on an email. So I just want to thank you all so much for joining this beautiful time of year as we transition from the hot and beautiful summer to the nice crisp fall. I just want to thank you all for taking, you know, an hour out of your day to be here with us for our discussion around unlocking potential. So really a guide to influencing teams and enhancing performance. I've had the pleasure of really interacting with the folks in the panel and really understanding, you know, the different types of ways that we influence within organizations and the depth of experience that they have. It'll be really great for folks to go ahead and put in chat any questions, use that Q&A box. We will be recording this and we'll be sending a follow-up afterwards so that you're able to actually connect with other folks. And then of course, always let it, you know, pop off in that chat and connect with each other. We see a lot of really great magic happen there. Already love seeing people from all over the States. Welcome, welcome. And in ThinkHuman and CultureAmp fashion, you know, really the intention with the panels that we put together is that we really want to help foster a mindset shift for you all, you know, helping you think about things in a different way so that you can take that back to your organization, take it back to your life and apply it a bit differently. So just to kick things off, I would love for folks to head back over to chat and tell me, why is it important to influence? Or how do you influence within your own organizations? Would love to hear from the folks here in the room. I like that, Rob, to be relevant, right? Okay, great. Yep. There's a lot of different ways that we influence, even if we don't know that we're influencing, and we'll definitely dig down into what it means to influence. What are effective ways to do that with an organization? Yep, to build trust and strong relationships. And we'll definitely be talking a bit about some of the skills, some of the soft skills that you develop to really help you influence, right? You got that engagement, culture, credibility. Thank you, Nicole, Susan, right? Touching every department in some type of way, right? I love this, I love this. Yeah, please keep it alive in the chat. I see a lot of great things happen when we interact with each other, when you ask questions, that definitely unlocks and inspires others as well. So this webinar would not be happening if it wasn't for the commitment and heartfelt work of the team here at ThinkHuman, as well as our amazing partner, CultureAmp. Because really, we are incredibly aligned on the power of creating a safe space to really dig into these topics, not just at a high level. And so really excited to introduce CultureAmp, who's our partner for today. For folks that aren't familiar, CultureAmp is the world's leading employee experience platform. I mean, they've helped over 6,500 companies just to create a better world of work, right? So they work with a lot of innovative companies that will have really helped them understand and share different strategies on how to create the most impactful people platform. And then ThinkHuman, that's the organization I am with. We are a manager training and leadership development organization. So really we help people leaders, L&D leaders, by offering outsourced trainings and executive coaching that really focuses on building the human skills in our leaders. So we'll have a poll that pops up later on, so you can let us know if you're interested in chatting with any of the partners. But without further ado, I'm actually gonna bring on our wonderful speakers today. So first we have Meredith Haberfeld, then we have Luke Kayga, and Tony Santana. There's a thunderous applause happening, I promise all of you. We can't quite hear it yet, but it's there if you just imagine it with me. Hello, how are you all doing today?
Hello.
Hello.
Good to meet
hey.
Everybody.
Doing excellent, thank you.
Good. Well, I'm gonna actually pass it over to you all. Would love to maybe start with Meredith. If you could just introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your role and maybe like how you connect to the idea of influence.
All right, cool. Well, Meredith Haberfeld, CEO of ThinkHuman, and I spend a lot of my time looking to understand the vision and goals of the organizations that we partner with so they can bring that vision for their culture and leadership to life. And as it relates to influence, I have been a student of human beings for my whole career. My original, like where I started in my career, was as a biochemist and neuroscientist. So I was looking at humans from the molecular and cellular level, and then have transitioned to, you know, over the years to the focus of and study of humans from the behavioral standpoint. And I feel like influence is such a fundamental, like at the bare, like at the essence of how humans, who are these pack animals, how we interrelate with one another and can create reality. So to me, it's like a fascinating area of study, just from a creative standpoint, and anything we want to make happen in the world requires influence. So, you know, obviously juicy. Should I turn it over to somebody? I turn it over to, if yes, Luke, take it away.
Perfect. Thanks, Meredith. Hi, everyone. Nice to meet you. My name is Luke Kayga. I'm a senior people scientist at CultureAmp. I'm also a graduate student in IO psychology at Baruch College in New York City. I'm about a month out from defending my dissertation, if I can stop procrastinating. So hopefully that will be done soon. But in my role with CultureAmp as a senior people scientist, influence is really sort of at the core of what I and other people scientists at CultureAmp do. The main sort of product we offer at CultureAmp is through using employee engagement surveys to collect data on how employees are engaged or maybe not so engaged at certain companies. And we analyze that data and offer guidance to organizations on how they can make their employees more engaged. We also do a lot of stuff in the performance management space and the employee development space. But really what I'm excited to talk about today is like how my experience in talking with organizational leaders has sort of informed or changed my perspective on how to, you know, effectively influence companies at scale. So looking forward to talking today. I'll go ahead and kick it over to Tony.
Thank you. Thank you, Luke. Yeah, I love hearing the psychoanalysis background of how Meredith views, influence, and then kind of the data back that with that from Luke. But for me, I'm Tony Santana. I work on our culture diversity and inclusion team at Dell Technologies, and influence is in everything that I do. To get my work done, there's a large amount of influence. And as Meredith said, it's foundational, right? These are, to me, it's so foundational that it happens at the personal level, right? And I think what you're going to hear from all of us, you're going to hear so many great little tidbits, and you're going to get a lot from this. But I think what you'll find that a common theme that you're going to hear from the three of us, and I do want to assume that Meredith and Luke would agree with me on this one, is that when it comes to influencing, it's all about empowerment, right? And it's about how you empower others. It's how you're empowered yourself and how you lead with that, right? And so I hope that from what you get from me out of this conversation are just some strategies into how you can influence in your space, and maybe even what it looks like in your workspace, because this can be your personal life, your professional life, wherever it is. We all have the power to influence. We're all influencers. And if you're in a corporate space, you know, it doesn't come top down. It goes laterally up, down, up, you know? So we all have it in us. We all have that power to harness. It's just a matter of unlocking those keys and those levers of success. So I hope to be able to share some of those levers with you today. And you're going to get tons of great stuff from the three of us. So excited to be here. Excited to engage with all of y'all.
I love it.
Can I get some hearts? Woo!
Yeah, exactly, right? Tony, that's the energy we're looking for. Okay, so all of us starting the day, midway in. You know, it's interesting because when I started talking with everyone here, I started recognizing how much we influence, in everything that we do. There's a book called When Execution Isn't Enough, Decoding Inspirational Leadership. And it talks about how influence has long been recognized as an essential element of leadership. It's the process of social influence in which one person is able to really aid and support others in the accomplishment of a common task. And HBR also says there are different types of ways to influence to achieve your goals, right? And so I think there's a lot of opportunity, a lot of different ways to go about influencing. But I think maybe a good way to kind of like level set between all of us, maybe we can start with Luke, if you want to go first. What does it mean to influence, and how does that work?
Sounds great. Yeah, it's a great question and an important one, I think. There are different perspectives, I think, on what it means to influence, depending on who you ask and maybe what level of the organization people are operating at. To me, regardless of what level you're operating at, influence is about enacting change through others, is probably what I would say is the key sort of foundational component of the word influence. I think it works by having somebody who has the means to enact change, but perhaps is resistant to change or skeptical of if the change would be a good idea, and showing them that it is in fact a good idea. And I think a lot of times what we do in the space with like HR professionals and maybe with organizational psychology backgrounds is we try to find alignment in the things that we try to influence for between organizational success and employee well-being. Contrary to what some people might think, those things often go hand in hand with one another. They're oftentimes not at odds with one another. And so I think to influence successfully in our space is to do things that contribute to employee well-being and promote organizational effectiveness.
Meredith, Tony?
Oh, do you want one of us to jump in? All right, sorry about that. You missed my cue. So in terms of what influence is, I think it's to shape reality. And it is to shape the reality of someone's beliefs, their perspective, their priorities, their behavior. And that could be of another individual, of another team, of a whole organization, of a culture. And I think we're always influencing. I think we don't notice necessarily what we're influencing, but we are always creating influence. So to me, the part of the exciting piece is noticing what ripple effect are we having? Is it the one we want to be having and being intentional about that? And then for the things that we do want to be influencing, kind of getting our hands on the dials of how do we make those things happen rather than like an automatic blind spot of whatever impact we're having. I mean, if you look at parents, They're influencing their kids. You look at executives, they're influencing, these are just obvious examples. They're influencing the organization. And I think we spend too much time looking to create something new rather than getting conscious about the things we are already influencing. And is it the influence we're looking for?
Mm. Yeah, such a great way to state that. And you know, again, my perspective influence, it's about persuasion, really. But when it comes down to it, it's about being authentic. It's about having empathy and really understanding the human connection, right? And it's really all about building genuine relationships and those principles of empathy, active listening, understanding others' perspectives are just as crucial, especially in the digital age, like being online as they are in person, right? And so kind of starting there and understanding kind of like where your role is in connecting with others, you know, and how you show up to connect with others, it really starts with yourself. So it's funny because I always do this. I like to do this exercise and I call it the Riz exercise, right? And it's like, how do you turn yourself on? It's your commitment to being on all the time because we can't be on all the time. So what I like to do is I do a chair turnaround, right? And I'll do it right now. And it's typically like this. If I'm like chilling right here, this is about me. Think about me personally. Like say I'm about to join this call. Right before I hit the call, I do this. We got this, you know, like, but you really got to do that. You got to bring the energy up. You got to bring the confidence up. You got to bring the charisma out, right? You got to open the ears, right? You got to be approachable, right? You got to be exciting, right? And then you have to listen, right? Mm-hmm. Like you think of all these factors that you're doing to be exciting and you're like, oh, now I got to share it. No, you have to listen. You absolutely have to listen. Because you have to seek to understand what those who you're trying to influence are valuing. And once you understand that, you can share and align to those values and be able to take small steps of influence to get to where you want to go. Essentially, influence is about persuasion. And it's in my marketing side. Before I was on the CD&I team, the culture, diversity, and inclusion side, I spent 15 years in marketing. There's a book by Seth Godin. It's called All Marketers Are Liars. And it's a brilliant book, but it's about manipulation, right? And it's about influencing. And there's so many, just as my other colleague said, there's so many different ways of influencing. And it's how do you put that tact in? You have a lot of people who will kind of bullhead it where they kind of go in and they say, I am going to go in and I am going to persuade you and I'm going to make sure that you're persuaded, right? And then there's more gentle ways of doing it. So it's all about understanding your style, understanding what you want out of it, understanding your audience, what their goals are, and how do you align those shared values together? And then, you know, your posturing and how you, you know, come to them. And by then you'll have the whole game plan, but influence is about persuasion. You have to be authentic. You have to be empathetic and you have to listen to understand what it is that you're influencing and what it is in the outcomes that you're trying to achieve.
I want to just jump on something you said about manipulation, because I think in a certain way, there's overlap between influence and manipulation. Like I think in a Venn diagram, there's some overlap, but I think the big distinction is that to me is that manipulation includes that influence is driving towards something that is to your own one's own benefit, and oftentimes without the awareness of the other person that's the driver, that there's not like a co-creation or a mutual agendas that are being held, but instead like good for like a win-lose, basically I win, you lose. And I think that's maybe like at the heart of really effective influence without authority. Like when you have authority, you can kind of drive something forward, or you can, if with or without authority, you can manipulate. But I think influence without authority that's well done is a recognition of no win lose. Like it's not like I lose, you win, or you win, I win, you lose, but how do we both co-create something that is for mutual benefit?
Absolutely. It should always be a win-win situation when you're influencing, and really what you're talking about is you're getting down to people's behaviors, right? And to what Luke was saying, it's about getting them to change their behaviors, getting them to do an action, right? And if they can see that that action aligns with their values, and maybe in an organization, it's and that drives up to the organizational strategies as well, that's where you would find it at. But yeah, you're absolutely right. You know, it's about those win-win situations, because those are small wins. And if you think about it, whenever you have influence, especially someone who is trying to influence like a senior leader, you have to take those small incremental wins, you know, because that's where you don't want to put something big or medium size in front of them, something bite size, so that they can see what you can show, and that they can see what you can do, so that you can have a baseline to build credibility, right? And I know we talked about credibility, Meredith and Luke, the other day, but yeah, it's about building the credibility so that you can begin to develop a relationship with that individual, so that you can pull those levers of influence and be able to shape what you're trying to do and align it to what they're trying to do as well.
Yeah, I think that's super, super important. I mean, yeah, you can see Karen here in chat, find the thing that matters the most to the person you're trying to influence, right? Meredith, you've talked about like co-creating solutions, and Luke, I love hearing you talk about like, you know, that focus and emphasis on employee well-being. I think it's like very clear that it's a collaborative process. It's not just one person trying to do a singular thing. And I think we've talked a lot of different areas and things to consider when you are trying to influence. Maybe we can dig a little bit deeper. And Luke, if you want to start off, like, what are some of the levers, or I like how Meredith said dials, levers or dials, to help you influence within an organization effectively?
Yeah. So I'm actually going to build off the point that Karen made in the chat, because I think like the levers to influence are really oftentimes the leaders in organizations. Now, influence is something that can be top down, like it can come from leadership down, people in the organization. It can be bottom up as well, right? There can be like groups of employees who bring their perspectives to leaders and influence upwards. So both can happen. But what we see oftentimes is that top-down influence is sort of people's like first instinct in terms of like, how can I make change here? I need to get in the room with leadership. When you're in the room with leadership, it's about knowing your audience, right? Like, some leaders are going to be more influenced by referencing data, right? So the lever or the dial there is making a data-driven argument. So if I go to a leader and I tell them, your employees are not engaged because they don't feel like they have good learning and development opportunities. So have you thought about installing more training programs or lessening their workload so that they have more time to engage in the training programs you already have? There could be a number of different things there, but I would reference like engagement data to make that point. Some leaders are more compelled by like a compelling narrative or a good story that you can give them. So if I can spin that to instead talking about engagement data and learning and development, I can sort of craft a narrative that employees that have good learning and development opportunities feel the sort of sense of commitment to their organization because they feel invested in, and I can reference more of the like psychology of how investing in your employees makes them feel more comfortable at your organization. So it's ultimately up to you to figure out like what is compelling to your audience. Is it the more data-driven approach? Is it the more narrative approach? But in my experience, it often is one of those two things when we're talking about organizational leaders. So finding out what is compelling to them, building a case upon that, and then trying to enact change that way by turning the dial, I think is ultimately what's best. But yeah, curious if Meredith or Tony have any follow-up thoughts there.
I would just break down the two domains of understanding the other person's world and how they look at the world to understanding how they like to receive information. Cause like, I'm super relational. I sometimes, in an effort to influence, I'm like, let's get a coffee. Let's get to know each other. And somebody who's not relational like that is like, back it up. I'm like not feeling good about this. This is not building trust and credibility for me. In fact, it feels bad. So understanding how they like to receive information and how they like, what does build trust and credibility for them? So like stylistically, and then also understanding their agenda, like what matters to them, like Karen and you, Luke, both said what matters to them. So those are two different things, like stylistic and then what matters to them. And I know it sounds so obvious, it's maybe not worth saying, but I think sometimes we care so much about the thing we care about. Like, of course you should invest in people, or of course inclusion matters. So we're just like speaking as though that is obvious and obviously matters to somebody else. But if we don't know what does matter to them, we're like shouting into the wind. It really takes time to back it up off what, like our own convictions, to understand what matters to them, validate what matters to them in our own minds, and then see like, okay, well, given that landscape of what matters to them, where does this fit in that? And how do I find that, sorry to Venn diagram it twice, but how do I find that point of overlap between what they care about and this issue? And if there is no point of overlap, I might need to take some other route. Like there's really no juice down, like, let me try to convince you of this thing that matters not at all to you. Then it's like a telemarketing call.
Excellent. I'm just curious, how many people are on the call work remotely? I do. I know that. I'm just curious. I'm just curious if the chat will blow up. But, you know, when we talk about influence and levers of influence, I love all the points that Meredith and Luke brought in. I just look at it as three different ways. And it really simplifies and brings it all together. It's about purpose. It is about that data, right? And it's about emotions, right? So for purpose, that's where your shared vision comes along, aligning to a shared vision, you know? The second one, again, is leveraging your data. And you all might know what I'm talking about when I say leveraging data. It's the difference between actually showing factual information versus going off of your gut feeling, right? The difference between that, let's talk about remote workers. Your performance evaluations are coming up. It's time for those, right? And you're like wondering, am I going to get a promotion? Am I going to get that raise? I've got other people who are sitting right next to my leader. They see all the work. You know, I feel that recency bias. I feel the proximity bias. Is my leader going to give me just as enough attention on my performance evaluation and critique me and my criteria with the same amount of just rigor as they're doing with the hybrid employees or the employees that are at desk, right? And when you have data, you can actually back that up factually. And I think Luke can attest to that, right? It can actually tell you how well are they actually performing based to their metrics. And that's what real leaders really need to look at. And then the last part is talking about the emotions. Well, what's the best way to captivate all of this through emotions? And what do we love to do right now in our content? We love to storytell, share that story, pull them on that journey, give them the emotional overarch of that journey, wrap in the data points, make it succinct with true actual case study testimonials, and then show where that all connects together to the greater vision, right? That's where you're going to find your influence, right? And also having a framework for influence will also help you be able to implement that in your own style.
Tony is so good. I always think about it's kind of like the science part of it is going to be those like frameworks and methodology, and that art part is going to be in that like more relational human skills. Yeah, I think that's a really important part to highlight. Yeah.
I want to add a little science to the art of the relationship part. I think that a very simple exercise for all the people function leaders here who are like, okay, these are the people specific groups I need to influence, is to write out like a ecosystem map of what do I need to influence? And they're like, there's maybe direct decision makers, there are indirect decision makers or influencers, and mapping that out and then color coding it green, yellow, red. It sounds like a little basic, but it's a very powerful exercise to be like, okay, here's the thing I'm looking to influence, whether it's next year's L&D budget or getting manager support for this program that we're, you know, this new perf system that we're launching. Like, okay, what does the ecosystem look like? How is the trust and credibility across this ecosystem? Where are their big levers? And then investing in those levers, but first starting with that map. So yes, it's, there's art to it, but there's also a bit of science.
That is really good advice. There is nothing better than having a visual mapping of your ecosystem and being able to understand how to navigate those inter-office or either interpersonal relationships that you have. So I'd take it a step further there, Meredith. I would say not only do you list those people that you're going to be engaging with, but understand what they do, right? Understand their priorities. And one of the things that you could do before you even engage with that individual is you can go to, maybe there's like a chief of staff or somebody in that organization that has just their strategy plan. And you can ask them, hey, can you share your strategy plan with me? I'm trying to really understand your organization. There's some things that we're doing in our organization and we just want to try to see where can we align. They love to share it, right? They love alignment on strategy. It's a win-win situation, right? So that is such a great, great call out. Anytime you can map out anything holistically, it helps you see the bigger picture. I love that.
I think it's such an interesting and such an interesting point that one of the ways that we influence is by listening. Like, no, we think of influencing as like a push rather than so much of influence is listening to understand another's world and perspective, even before we go out there with whatever we're pitching. I don't know if you saw this, Luke, in the chat, but just to take a little detour for a second to somebody, a question that's in the Q&A, Haley is asking if you have any advice on how to use data and encourage leadership to take data seriously. And it's a question, what it says, our leadership is focused on gut feelings, what's on their mind at the moment, rather than looking at the data to understand current issues. So any thoughts on that one?
Yeah, so great question, Haley. This is something that, you know, we are not strangers to seeing necessarily. So oftentimes people in positions of power or leadership positions have, you know, gotten there in part because of, you know, professional success, and that professional success leads them to be like confident about certain stances they have on things. And so it might take more than just showing them data to convince them. What I found useful is finding data that does align with some of the gut feelings that they do have, because when you can do that, you can sort of open the door for future data-backed arguments landing better. If we all hold different opinions and perspectives on things. I'm sure everyone in this room has had a moment in their life where they had a strongly held opinion, saw data that contradicted that opinion, and you didn't just immediately switch your opinion because the data said so, right? Like influencing and perspective changing is a sort of gradual process that takes more than one instance of seeing data that contradicts your point of view to fully change your point of view. A good way to influence is when you can find alignment between data that you do have and gut feelings that people have, because then, oh, well, now data is great in their eyes. Like, oh, of course, the data says that. That's what I believe. But then if you can show them that and then later down the line, show them data that contradicts maybe an opinion they have or offers a counter perspective or a alternative perspective to something they have, you can sort of over time build somebody who's a little bit more open-minded to data-backed arguments. Though I will just preface or close this by saying, easier said than done. It's difficult to do, but it's not impossible.
You just made me think of something. Oh, go ahead, please, Tony.
I was just going to say something funny and saying this is where Keenan Ivory Wayne's needs to pop up and say message, because Luke just dropped some knowledge bombs on us right there. All right, that is something that you do not see typically. I love that behavior, Luke. Those are very positive behaviors. You typically don't see that. Typically what you do see is when you present data and a senior leader kind of dismisses it, you typically don't see the person that's presenting the data be like, let me find what you're actually like interested in and what you are presenting and then try to align that. That is very smart. And that is one way to not get defeated when you're trying to overcome some of these obstacles and challenges.
Thank you.
Plus one to all of that. And the thing you made me think of is I used to have a work colleague who would talk a lot about the difference between motivation and inspiration. And how she defined this difference is that to motivate somebody to do something was a push. You're like trying to get them to go in a certain direction. And to have someone have inspiration to do something, they're pulled, like they are drawn towards something. And I think we can use data in service of creating that inspiration for them, but you can't create inspiration. Well, there's two things about inspiration. Number one, for those leaders that are all gut driven and operating in the world of like, you know, the latest shiny thing and what they've been thinking about and recency bias, using those things, like tapping into, okay, well, what are they caring about and what is in their current zeitgeist? And then how do I create something they are inspired or drawn toward inside of that, with or without the data? So I think it's like, if we get out of the mode of driving them towards something and into the mode of what might create inspiration for them, it changes our lens and how we would even use the data.
Yeah, I love that you said that, because so Luke can probably go into a little bit further detail in this, because now you're actually talking about behavioral metrics, right? So inspiration, the best way to be inspired by somebody is to see them leading by example, right? So as a leader, if you want your team members to exhibit certain behaviors, guess what you're going to have to do? You're going to have to exhibit those behaviors. So that means if you want your team members to work collaboratively and you want them to work very with a lot of openness and transparency and everything like that, do a certain thing, a certain way, you have to do it that certain way. You got to lead by example. That's inspiring. When people see you do that, they mimic those behaviors themselves. That's where Meredith's talking about being pulled in. Now, on the motivation part, being pushed, in the employee experience and employee engagement, what we're really looking at is what are those activators of motivations? And it's understanding your team members' aspirations. Once you understand your team members' aspirations, you understand what their motivators are, and you know exactly how to activate them. That right there is not, two people need to know how to do that. You yourself, for yourself, and leaders. Leaders need to know what you aspire to. Even if it sounds like what you aspire to conflicts with your job, no. Let me tell you, in my company, when I consult with leaders, we build leaders to be able to build their teams for success and growth to where they're going to go, even if that means that they're going to go outside of the company, right? That is a leader's responsibility. A great leader will always cycle their team out, build people in, move them out, build them up, move them out, build them up, move them out. Because once you build them up, there's not much you can really do anymore except send them to a better leader. And to understand that. One of my favorite examples of great leadership styles, and I can't think of her last name, but Jacinda, the former prime minister of New Zealand. Do y'all recall when she retired, why she retired? She said, I did a lot of great things. I'm the youngest female prime minister. We've done so much. This has been the last, going through COVID, very, very stressful for me. I've been through the ringer on it. I know that emotionally and mentally that I am not the best leader here to continue to lead New Zealand. And I need to step down so someone else who's got the capacity can step up and lead. That is leadership, knowing when to step down, right? So it's all about understanding what your aspirations are of your team members so that you can like activate what motivates them. And that all directly drives to performance. Absolutely.
There's a question in the chat from famous Karen. Luke, I feel like it'd be, given your role, really useful to hear your thoughts on this. Regarding finding out how people want to receive information when you're a team of one supporting a company of 3,000, how do you suggest you scale the approach to literally hundreds of leaders? So thoughts on how to understand how people want to get the information when you're dealing with a very wide audience?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's a great question. I think a piece of insight I can give here is that when organization-wide messages or initiatives are being rolled out, one of the worst things that can happen is people feeling like they weren't included at all in the ideation process of how that initiative was designed. People felt like they didn't get to give their input into the purpose of the initiative and things like that. And so if you're a team of one, supporting a company of 3,000, I have, you know, some work ahead and it's going to be challenging. But I think whenever we're talking about like people receiving information, perhaps about like a new initiative or a new program that's being rolled out in an organization, people don't want to be blindsided by that information. So the way that we circumvent that potential for people being blindsided about information is one, there needs to be alignment between leaders and managers on the rollout of the initiative. So like leaders at a company, and by leaders, I mean like people at the higher levels, need to want to roll out the information, tell managers that this is going to be rolled out. So managers need to tell their subordinates. And then in addition to managers having conversations with their subordinates about this information or this new initiative, then you can do things like message boards, email blasts, and things of that nature. Another thing I'll add is that like people need to hear things more than once in order to understand new information or a new initiative. And that's why it's important for managers to communicate information, but also for leaders to do things like email blasts or message boards and things of that nature. Hopefully that's helpful, Karen. Said I was thinking more about how to share data differently with several people. Okay, so with that, I think my perspective is going to be like, what is the purpose of the data? Is the data evaluating different departments in the organization, different teams? Is it about initiatives? Because ultimately, you don't want to share data that's not relevant for people in the organization. So if there's something about 100 of the 3,000 employees that the other 2,900 don't need to hear, then probably not doing that big email blast thing I was talking about.
I love that. Look, I also love the image of like bringing people along with you in that journey. I think that's something that even we do like at ThinkHuman that's been really impactful for me. We don't just like roll out a change. We're like, this is what we're doing. We really like we're intentional. We create the time and space to introduce it to somebody. Then we go back and we talk about it again. Right. Again, I think that also hits on the idea of like, how do we align and how do we co-create together? And that's not going to happen in just like a single meeting. If someone's not familiar with how you're using the words you're using, or maybe they're not really connected to like the why or really understanding what's happening. So I'm going to take a quick pause. I'm going to launch a poll here for folks. If you are interested in connecting with ThinkHuman or with CultureAmp after this, want to put this up for folks, I'll leave it here for a few seconds. And then we'll carry on. So I can't believe we're already got like 17 minutes left. I don't know how that happened, as it always does. And I kind of want to help us transition a little bit into, you know, some of the things that people can really take away with them. I think we've hit on a lot of different places. We've talked about like what is influence, how anybody can influence, no matter like the level in the organization. You know, there is the art element, and then there is also the science component as we think about strategies and frameworks. And so maybe a place that, you know, Meredith, I'm really curious to hear from you because of also like your work on the people development space. As folks kind of take what we've talked about today and kind of move forward, what do you think are some important like skills or things for folks to develop as they want to improve their ability to influence within their companies?
I'm going to circuitously answer your question, but I will answer your question. So. Great. A framework that we love at ThinkHuman for influence is frame it, pitch it, guide it, close it. Frame it being understand the world of the, like, what's the ecosystem you're trying to influence for the person that you're trying to influence specifically? How do they need to be set up so that they are like open and receptive to this influence conversation. So that takes empathy. I said I was going to loop back. So empathy is one skill. Next is pitching it. And in the pitch, being able to set the stage and articulate your ask or the topic, not from the perspective of your own beliefs and agenda, but knowing you have beliefs and an agenda, not like I am the source of truth and they have an agenda. No, like I've got an agenda, they've got an agenda. And how do I pitch this in a way that speaks to their agenda? That's pitch it. Then guide it is asking open-ended questions, like a handful of them, at minimum three, to understand how they think about this issue. Like, what are their concerns, their reservations? What do they imagine happening if this were to happen? And getting in their world so that you can land at a new and different place than you started. In the best influence situations, like you think you know what you're trying to influence, like what the outcome looks like, but oftentimes the outcome, the final outcome out of a co-creation might even be better than the thing you originally were imagining if you're in that open world of like, okay, well, here's my agenda. There's their agenda. Let me understand that overlap and then drive towards something collectively together. So once again, I think that's question asking as a skill. And again, empathy, being able to see the world through someone else's eyes without losing your own self to find where are those overlapping points. And then closing it, being able to really clearly articulate where did we land from this conversation? Because so often we like leave the conversation and we're like, all right, here's where we landed. We think that. And they're like, oh, I think we landed over here. And then all of a sudden we haven't actually moved something forward. So being able to articulate, all right, here's where we landed. Here's where we're going next, which oftentimes is another conversation. It's as has been mentioned a couple of times, not a one and done. So to wrap that up, I think the key skills are empathy, asking questions, understanding somebody else's agenda, and then being able to clearly articulate where we landed together and what our next step is. Other different thoughts from the community in the chat or Luke and Tony?
I, for one, would love to see what the chat thinks of themselves. You know, I think a simple way to influence, again, is just going back to the framework. A great framework. There's several different ones. The one that, like, there two of them pop up to my top of my head. It's the PI framework and then the four C's. The four C's for me is the one that you could essentially use it professionally. You can also use it in your personal life too. The PI is more related to like project teams, I would say, but like the four C's would be like clarity, consistency, collaboration, and compassion. And what that means is you have to be clear about your expectations, right? You have to be clear about your roles, and you have to be clear about the outcomes that you want to achieve. Under consistency, you want to make sure that you're building trust through those consistent actions and communications, right? And demonstrating that you're reliable, right? That's where you're building your credibility. That's where you're building your relationships. The collaboration is just simply, again, fostering that culture of co-creation of what Meredith was talking about, you know, and this is really talking about team members feeling ownership, right? And those that feel more ownership, they feel like they're going to be more likely to perform and buy into certain initiatives and things of that nature, right? So that's where the collaboration and the compassion part is. We're all humans, right? And as leaders, human-centric leadership ensures people feel seen and valued. And it really takes the individual's personal development goals and how they can potentially align with the team's objectives and the overall business objective. And then the other part too, Tilly and I, we had this conversation around leaders and L and B, right? And one of the things that I called out in terms of influence and these frameworks is that if you go from one company, and Luke, you can probably attest to this, you can go from one company to the next. Their L&D, their leadership development offerings would look different, right? You go from that company to another, you can be in the same industry. You can go to another company, those development offerings look different, right? Yet when we get down to the core of what happens, like let's say layoffs, all of these layoffs happening all across industries, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, I think millions of people have been laid off in the last couple of years, right? If you look at that and you say, okay, so on the broad level, right, corporations have a lot of pull or a lot of factor when it comes to a person's happiness, right? And so do they have a role that they play in is there a role that leaders need to play in having a consistent development program that highlights compassion? Because we need to move beyond empathy, right? Let's be honest. We need to move beyond empathy. And Harvard Business Review actually did an amazing article on compassion over empathy. And in my line of work, we hear about intentions all the time. Let's do this initiative. It's going to have great intentions. And I always say, well, what's the outcomes? Because I'm outcomes over intentions. It can be great intentions. That sounds good. I'll clap my hands to that. But if it doesn't align to business outcomes, I don't want to hear about it, to be quite honest. I mean, I'll listen, but it just doesn't align to like where I need to be put my time and my focus too. So I kind of would leave it kind of like at that in those rounds. But like, if we can start really looking at the leadership development and how can we as corporations across the industry standardize how leaders are developed, we can start to see fundamental changes in the way that people are led in corporate America. And that is the problem, is it's inconsistent across corporate America. And we allow corporations to get many, many tax breaks. We have all of these legislations against certain things, but we don't tell them how they're going to treat the people, right? We do based on like discrimination policies and things of that nature, but we don't give them the development that they need, right? So that's my take on that stuff.
I'd love to quickly build off that point because I think Meredith and Tony and the last two pieces of information you gave, you both unveiled important things. One, I do like that framework of frame it, pitch it, guide it, close it. I think one thing I want to highlight in when we're thinking about like framing a influential message of sorts, one thing that we're trained to do at CultureAmp, which is something that I didn't really learn prior to coming to CultureAmp, is that in influencing, a very underutilized tool is just asking more discovery questions of your audience. So when you're thinking of framing something, for example, like if I'm working with two different companies, like Tony was saying, and they're both doing leadership development type stuff, if we run our engagement surveys with them and it both turns out that their high potential employees aren't satisfied with their leadership development opportunities, one instinct I could have is just to go right into, okay, let me make a presentation deck, give it to both companies explaining why leadership development is important and it works according to research. Like I could do that. But if I didn't ask further discovery questions, I might miss something. So for example, at one company, it might be the problem that they don't have enough leadership development programs to support all of their high potentials. At another company, it could be the problem that they have plenty of leadership development programs, but they're overworking their high potentials, so they don't have enough time to access the programs that they already have in-house. If I just gave both of those companies the same presentation or same influential message, it might not land as well with both of them. But if I cater my message to a more specific sort of influence through asking questions about why is leadership development not working at your company, I might be able to use the frame it part of the one influence framework more effectively. So I just wanted to highlight that everyone in this room, I imagine, is in here in part because they're curious about human beings and they find human beings fascinating. Use that curiosity to your advantage.
Hallelujah.
Good point. Yeah.
So agree. I'm also just thinking in terms, I know we're still kind of circling around this question of skills, but question asking plus the ability to, I think you said this actually at the start, Luke, about the ability to narrate something. I think one of the main reasons people say no is to whatever we're trying to influence is the opportunity just isn't big enough. It's like, well, like there's a million things to do. What's the opportunity of this? Of all the things, why this? And being able to first understand their world well enough and then be able to narrate the impact and opportunity in such a way, whether it's using data, whether it's using other things, visuals, emotion, being able to paint that picture together with them. And I think actually one of the ways we paint the picture is not even with our own words, but again, with questions, like what would that, asking them, like, what would that look like? And how would that play out? And letting them start to paint the picture through the questions that we're asking, but being able to create, I think that's like a important pivot point is when the opportunity all of a sudden becomes big enough or the risk small enough through the conversation that they're like, oh, okay, there is something here.
Right. And I just want to make one call out that this, what y'all just talked about, actually connects to your question, Karen, about how to share data differently with several people. When you can drill down and ask those type of questions, you can understand what it is that they need to see. Typically, too, when you're talking about leaders, one of the things that you want to find out is what is it that they need to present on? Right. Yeah. And then you can find what it is that you need to show them and provide to them. So I think what y'all said was beautifully answers Karen's question on how do I share that out with different people. Leverage champions across your organization as well. Leverage any sort of self-service model that you have so that leaders can consume different formats of media, and then make sure that those continuous loops of feedback are just ongoing cycles. So that's how I'd answer that. And I love how y'all just said that. So I just wanted to make sure that it connected so that Karen didn't feel like she didn't get her answer.
Oh, that was a great double click. I mean, we only have a few minutes left. So I want to definitely go around and kind of get folks on their one takeaway. But there's just like such a lot of richness to this. And I feel like, again, as you think about influencing within an organization, you think about, I have to put my business hat on and I have to push my objective forward. And I feel like what we're hearing here is like, this is wanting to influence is another opportunity to get curious, remain human, and connect with other people in your team, right? When you talk about co-creation, it's like, if you see that there's an issue within your team or within the company and you bring that idea forward, that's an opportunity to collaborate and connect with someone, your leader or one of your peers. And that's that kind of back and forth process that happens through getting curious, through further discovery, right? And really like getting clarity on what is important and why you're doing what you're doing. And I think that also helps in the role of prioritizing in your own role and across the organization. And as always, hearing how important it is that leadership really emulates or demonstrates what this behavior looks like, and that a leader is absolutely anybody. It's not just dependent upon that title. Everyone's empowered to take things forward, to get curious, and to influence on any kind of outcomes. So thank you all so, so much. Really appreciate just the thoughtfulness and intentionality here. There's that word, intention. We've talked about a lot of different things. If folks were going to take away kind of one idea, one guidepost or strategy, what would that be? And I'll hand it over to, how about Tony, you first.
If you could take away one thing, just know, I would say, wow, there's so much. What can you take away? Oh my goodness. Know your audience. If you could understand one thing, know your audience. That means do the research before you engage. Understand the interconnectivity to the work and the strategy of your organization and all your personal strategies of success as well.
Thanks.
I was also going to say know your audience, but I'm happy to take a different angle. I think I would 100% reiterate Tony's point that like knowing your audience is so important. Different persuasion attempts will land differently with different audience. So maybe something I'll say is, when you're trying to influence, it's not always going to work. In fact, I think if you're batting above 50%, you're probably doing very, very good in this space when it comes to influencing. So you kind of have to have a little bit of a shortened memory, I think, in this space, you know, like not everything's always going to work. The world of work isn't going to change because of one meeting you have with a leadership team. But through being patient and through just, you know, understanding that you know what you're talking about, leveraging data and perfecting your ability to craft compelling narratives over time, you will be an influential person in this space throughout your career.
Meredith, you want to
close I'll wrap up with, I'll play the other side of know your audience and go with, take a deeper cut at your own blind spots and know yourself. So check out what are your drivers, instead of being so gripped to this is the specific outcome I need, being willing to loosen our grip to what success has to look like and what are all the alternatives that are even very different from the ones you originally thought of that might fulfill on those drivers, and then playing the long game.
Love it. Well, thank you all for just like your generosity, for your time, the gifts that you've given to everybody, interacting with folks. I appreciate you all for taking the time, and thanks to the community for chiming in. Special shout out to Karen. We appreciate all of you, and until next time.
Thank you all.
Thank you all.
Ciao.